Hello and welcome to the in-news series of Drishti IAS. I am Pooja Dwivedi, and in this segment today, we are going to talk about what the Indian government is doing in order to safeguard its coastal areas and enhance its coastal security. Now, this topic is important from the perspective of prelims, also from the perspective of GS Mains Paper 1, and very important from the perspective of GS Mains Paper 2. So, let's begin with the topics of discussion step by step. First of all, we will talk about Wine News, which will be followed by Coastal Radar Chain Network and what India is doing, how India is integrating its neighboring littoral states in order to mitigate the negative impacts of Chinese presence. We will also talk about the necessities for integrating more and more countries. We will talk about the challenges. Now here, we will also discuss the very important theory, String of Pearls. This particular theory pertains to Chinese encirclement of the Indian region. We will also talk about the way forward, and in the midst of this segment, I will ask you few prelims-based questions. Comment the correct answer in the comment segment. So let's begin with Wine News. As a part of India's efforts in order to enhance and strengthen the coastal radar network chain, this particular chain, India is talking with its neighboring littoral states of Bangladesh, Maldives, and Myanmar to set up a station there in order to exchange real-time monitoring of the threats that are in the Indian Ocean region. So if we talk about the states which are included in this particular network, if you look at this map, this is the map which will show you the states which are integrated with India's radar chain system, and the blue ones are in advanced talks with India, and the yellow ones, which is Seychelles, Mauritius and Sri Lanka, they already have a station of India. Now, why is this? Because of rising Chinese vessels in this particular region. So, India is in talks with the blue countries, the blue states, and already integrated the yellow ones. And also, if you see this news is not new, it's very old, in fact 5 years old, when the Prime Minister of India went to Seychelles and made operational one of the stations situated in Seychelles. Okay, so this pertains to 2015. Then again, Maldives, you can see this particular news which says that this is of 2019, which says that the network system is working there, and it's again, India is again going on with its network system there. And also, India is in talks with Philippines as well. India has proposed to set up a station there. Also, the state of Thailand is also included in this particular talks. So, you can see how India is coming, making more countries come on board in this particular network system. So, if we talk about this entire system, we will talk about the concept one by one. If we talk about what is a surveillance system in the coastal region, what is this? This is a network of many sensors in order to look at the objects or an individual and track its movement. And as the objects move closer to the Indian territory, its resolution becomes more higher. So I'm just moving away from the screen. You can screenshot this. So, as a part of coastal security mechanism, a surveillance system called Coastal Surveillance Network, which comprises of chain of static sensors having radars, automatic identification system, day and night cameras, and MET sensors at 46 locations along the coastline and islands has been established by the Indian Coast Guards. So, it is a particular chain of not only radar system, static radars, static sensors, but also automatic identification system. Now, if we talk about automatic identification system, this particular system, what does it do? It shares real-time location of ships and transmits the data related to that ship to different ships in order to avoid collision. Okay? And also, day and night camera, everything is included in here, and this is a part of the bigger strategy. So if we talk about the strategy involves building ports, like India is building ports in different countries, different stations, and also extensive coastal surveillance radar systems and What is the aim? The aim is to track the warships and submarines of states which are aggressive in nature, such as China. So, importing state-of-the-art surveillance planes is also included, which can track down submarines operating airport in neighboring countries to keep a check on the ports built by China. So, China has built its ports in many neighboring countries of India, such as the Gwadar port, very famous port, a very big part of the flagship program of CPEC. Okay? What is the aim? Now, we have to, until and unless we don't understand the aim, we won't be able to move forward. So, if we talk about the aim is to deepen defense ties, expanding bilateral relations with South Asian countries, island nations in Indian Ocean region, Southeast Asian nations, and carrying out regular military exercises with navies of USA, Japan, and Australia. So, if you look at this particular statement, this is filled with overtones of rising Chinese presence, right? And its nodal agency, if we talk about, the Indian Navy's Information Management and Analysis Center, or IMAC, is the nodal agency, and it is based in Gurugram, which was set up after the 26/11 Mumbai terror attacks, because we know that the terrorists of the Mumbai attacks, they accessed our lands through the ocean region. So, if we talk about IMAC, it was established in the year 2014, and very interesting, it tracks non-military and commercial ships, which is white shipping. You have to tell me in the comment segment which agency tracks the military ships or grey hull ships. Okay, so this was established in the year 2014, and it makes sure that Indian Navy, Coast Guards and Marine Police, they all work in a coordinated manner, and its work is to record real-time data and also disseminate it. Okay, so this IMAC is the nodal agency for this particular system, for this particular strategy. Okay, moving on. Let's talk about Navy's Information Fusion Center. This particular institution was established in the year 2018 in the month of December, with the association of 22 littoral states, 22 neighboring, if not neighboring, then of course the countries which are having interest in the Indian Ocean region, such as Australia, France, New Zealand, Bangladesh, Myanmar. So what does it do? It actually facilitates the dissemination of real-time marine information. And this particular agency is also responsible for maintaining coastal security. Okay, so moving on. Before that, let's discuss what is the significance of Indian Ocean region. So, 75% of the global trade goes through Indian Ocean region, and 50% of the global consumption goes through Indian Ocean region. Then of course it's very important to maintain the security and openness of this particular region. What China is doing, there has been increase in the deployment of Chinese research vessels in the southeastern and western regions of the Indian Ocean, and under the pretext of conducting anti-piracy operation, there has been a rise and increase in Chinese naval ships as well as submarines. So, of course, all the states which share boundaries with the Indian Ocean and all the states that have stake in the Indian Ocean region have very much been alert about this. So, that is the reason, that is the very big reason for India, because India wants to be a regional player, and not only a regional player now, India wants to be an international player. So, for that, India needs to maintain its security and sovereignty. Now, India is already in a very impasse position, in a very deadlock position with China in the Himalayan region. And also, China is trying to intrude into the political structure, the political structure of Nepal. So, many countries with which India is a boundary are under a threat. Because if these countries start to, if the littoral countries and the neighboring countries start to come under the pressure of China, what will happen? Its security will be threatened. So that is the reason India needs to secure not only its land borders, but also its sea borders. Okay. So the IOR surveillance system, if we talk about the necessity, is widely seen as India's response to China's aggression in the region. So, of course, if we talk about the aggression in the region, we must talk about the string of pearls theory. So, if we talk about the string of pearls theory, this particular project, Chinese media has never openly said that, it hasn't ever used this term that yes, we are moving on with our string of pearls theory. But it is very much used in the Indian media section. So, this particular theory is a geographical theory, which is related to Chinese intentions, that is military, commercial and sea lines communication, as well as through diplomatic channels in the Indian Ocean. Now, you may be able to understand it with the help of this diagram. Can you see this? I talked about the Gwadar port. Chinese military has its presence there. Then comes at Chittagong, China has a presence here as well. Sri Lanka, at Hambantota and Colombo, these two ports are also working under China. So as you can see that China is trying to encircle the Indian region. If India does not encounter this with a similar strategy, India will lose big time in the near future. So that is the reason I was telling you time and again that yes, India is trying to counter this particular strategy with the help of the radar network chain. Alright, so I hope you have understood this. I have tried to brief you in very few lines. You can also read about it at our Drishti official website. Okay, so a string of pearls, I'm moving away, you can write it down. A string of pearls includes container facility in Chittagong, that is Bangladesh, facility at Karachi and Gwadar port in Pakistan and Colombo, and Hambantota, because as we talked, Colombo and Hambantota both are in Sri Lanka, and also includes other facilities. So this is the biggest necessity. This has been the biggest necessity for India to get alert about Chinese presence. And data exchange, the other necessity, that the data exchange would also be useful for anti-terror and anti-piracy operations. Now terrorism is something that is infesting the entire world. It's a very chronic problem. So terrorism should be curbed at land, at sea, at air. So this would prove very helpful, prove to be very helpful. And send coastal radar network, this entire chain will improve the operational capabilities of maritime forces, security forces of the nation. And of course, when the security of a particular place is maintained, what will happen? Its economy will get enhanced. And this particular economy, which is surrounded by the ocean region, is known as blue economy, right? So these are the necessities we discussed. Now we will discuss the challenges. Biggest challenge right now for any country, not just for India, is to build trust after the COVID-19 induced lockdown. And of course, after the COVID-19 pandemic itself, trust has eroded at every level for each and every country. So right now, the biggest challenge is to build trust. Now, India should not make it look like that when it's building stations, it's doing it just for its own sake. It should look beyond the India and China prism, beyond this particular prism. So building trust should be there. Second, China's debt trap diplomacy. What is this? We will talk about it in detail. First, you have to write it down. China has been using the financial tool of debt to gain influence across the world and grab considerable power in India's neighboring countries, thereby increasing the amount of political and security threats the nation is exposed to. So what is this exactly? So what is happening? China has billions and billions of dollars at its disposition. So what it is doing, it is trying to create a hegemony around the Asian region at least, that yes, we will provide you loans at a very concessional rate, at a very low rate. So as you can see, in 2000, the loans that were being provided to low and middle income countries were at the rate of 5.85%. Well enough. And now you can see that this is sourced from World Bank. Now you can see after 20 years, it has gone to as low as 4.35 years. So what the low income countries and the middle income countries do, they get attracted by this, that they are providing loans for heavy infrastructural projects at such a low rate. So they take the loans. And what happens after that? They are unable to keep pace and they are unable to repay the debts. So what happens after that? China then asks for some kind of concessions or some advances, in the sense that if we talk about the Sri Lankan context, now as Sri Lanka was unable to repay its debt properly, what happened? They, Sri Lankan government, gave the Hambantota port to China for 99 years. Now that has become a big problem for India, because it's just at its Chinese presence is just at India's doorstep. And Angola here, same problem happened with Angola. Angola is repaying the debts in crude oil. So that is causing problem in their country. This is what debt trap diplomacy of China is. And this is a challenge for India. And if all the countries, Maldives, Myanmar, they come under this debt, what will happen? They will become weak and their political structure will start to crumble. And then India will be at a really disadvantageous and very precarious position. Okay, next thing. Political instability. How? Sometimes what happens, these small states, they get proxy presence of big countries like China, and their political structure sometimes become pro-India or pro-China. So this is also a very big challenge for India. How to balance it? Balance it in the sense that India should not look like China to the rest of the world. China is trying to become the big brother here, but actually what should be? India should take the advantage of the cultural proximities with different countries and not China. So this is also a big problem here. How to maintain political stability in these countries and not look like a very large looming country that is trying to build on their weakness. Okay, now if we talk about the way forward. I think we covered the way forward step by step with the challenges only. But first, let's write it down if you can. India should strengthen its ties with the stakeholder countries using all tracks of diplomacy. By using all tracks of diplomacy, there are three tracks: track one, track two, track three. So India should exhaust all its tracks of diplomacy and boost people-to-people connectivity. Take advantage of the cultural and geographical proximity. Alright? And then also, India should ensure that whatever the arrangement is being made with these countries are not at the cost of their sovereignty and their security. That is also very important. And India should make sure to deepen the bilateral relationship going beyond the border security. That means India should enhance its engagements in fields such as technology transfer, clean energy, artificial intelligence, economic relations also should be enhanced. So there are so many tools that India can use to enhance the bilateral relation, and India does have the ability to become not only a regional player but also a global leader. So that's it for today. Tomorrow we shall meet again with another segment. Until then, stay updated and thank you so much for watching.